their way back. I'd like to introduce Chris Knapp of Udemy.
Thanks very much. So this is a reproducible build. It's a bit of a tongue twister, and it's very difficult to actually say the word builds in a loud place without a microphone. Some diction issues. So some brief stuff about me. I'm a freelance programmer. I'm currently the Debian project leader. I contribute to a whole bunch of open source free software stuff. I currently have a grant Linux Foundation to work on reproducible builds, essentially a full-time basis, which is really, really good. And thank you to them. I do a bunch of stuff from very low-level stuff as a freelancer, low-level stuff all the way up to sort of full-stack web framework, JavaScript stuff. I really, really enjoy the just jumping between the two. So reproducible builds, okay, so what problem are we actually trying to solve here? So as I try and explain, so the problem is really that for free software, you can inspect the source code. You can download the source code for Nginx, Apache, whatever you like, and look at it and see whether someone has inserted any malicious flaws. You know, have they deliberately added little backdoors or very clever logic things or off by wire errors? You know, I'm just adding this bit of source code. As a rootkit, essentially. So whilst you can inspect the source code for any free software, which is by definition, distributions are providing binary packages in the form of devs, in the form of EXEs, in the form of RPFs, etc. And that's great, it's very highly convenient. So you can be in your own chat. Compiling your own software is just not practical. And so can we trust this process of transforming the source that we will assume is trusted? Can we trust the binaries we get, the binaries we install, and therefore the software that we're actually running actually corresponds to this source code and hasn't been mucked around in the process? And by mucking around, I mean, what are the sort of targets here? So if you could get all distributions run some sort of build network, so the OpenSUSE build service, SUSE Studio, the Debian build deeds, just anything, or even just random developers' machines who things like that, developer machines. So, for example, if you're the creator of a Bitcoin wallet software and you're making a Windows build, you load up Visual Studio here. Well, if your machine has been compromised, you've no idea really what that EXE may contain. He's going to upload it to his website and say, yeah, this is what I've built, and here's the source code, and I'm a pretty cool guy. You trust me, right? But because his software's got some malware on, that EXE now contains, you have absolutely no idea. So can you trust all your money? It goes worse than that, because I could quite cheaply, I reckon, if you know the right people, you could probably send someone around to this hypothetical Bitcoin wallet, flat or apartment, and say, well, you like your family, right? You wouldn't want anything nasty to happen to them, so perhaps you just want to, install this piece of software, publish this source code, but when you go and upload, perhaps publish this slightly different source code. We're not going to really tell you what it's about, but so it makes currently anyone who distributes binaries is essentially a source for sort of blackmail in that sense, because they can be co-opted into distributing corrupt binaries. So there's some prior art on this. There was this was a few years ago now, there was a bogus iOS SDK understand it, it's one version of it at least just replaced that Apple software's the distributors had adverts in their app to monetize it, and it would just simply replace it with their own ads. And so, and the really nefarious thing is that they would be like, what's going on? Rebuild and re-upload. The source code is absolutely fine. What's going on? Because their SDK, their build tools, their compilers were compromised. The software that they were actually uploading did not correspond to that source. So they suffered. And you don't need big changes in binaries for such a big effect. There was a root exploit in OpenSSH, and you could, a few years ago, and one way you could fix it, obviously, is to just upgrade your packages and recompile the OpenSSL. Because it was a sort of off-by-one error, what you could do is just binary patch the OpenSSL binary, just use a bin OpenSSL. And you only have to change one bit, because you're just changing like a jump if equal to a jump if not equal, something very, very small. And so that basically turned, although that was going the other way around, turning a vulnerable OpenSSL binary into a slightly more less vulnerable one. You could do it the other way around, just one bit change could turn it back into one with a known root exploit. You also just literally can't trust what's being displayed to you on your computer. So there's a rather cool kernel module that when you load up the source code in your editor, you get one version, but when it's seen by GCC, you see a completely different version, which in this hypothetical scenario, it has a root kit and things like that. And you can check that out on media.ccc.de. So the whole motivation to reproducing builds is to ensure that to allow verification that no flaws have been introduced during compilation. So that's our kind of technical definition. And our solution for this is as follows. What we do is we basically ensure that compilation always produces the same results. So you have some source code and the definition of the compilers and the build environment around that. And the idea is that if you always get the same result at the end, that's what we call identical. So I mean, and by that identical, I mean bit for bit identical. So ran SHA-1 sum or MD5 sum, you get literally the same cryptographic signature. What you then do is multiple parties, so me, you, whoever, also compiles it with the same source and the same build dependencies. And we compare the results of the checksums that we get at the end of it. Therefore, this means that the attacker must infect everyone simultaneously. Because well, I'll just run through an example on that page. So, if Alice compiles Nginx and gets a checksum of ABCDEF and says, hey, I get ABCDEF, a Bob, like, oh, I also get ABCDEF. Interesting, okay. And Carol gets DEFABC with the same source and the same thing and the same build dependency, etc., the same tool chain. We should be trustworthy, we shouldn't trust Carol's build, because we don't know why hers is different. Maybe her compiler's logic, maybe her, basically anything in that tool chain is now suspect, and things like that. So that's basically the way we do it. So what are the causes of non-reproducibility in software? There's quite a few. The main one we encounter is timestamps. So the software loves to include timestamps. Oh, I was compiled on this day. Documentation I'm going to say last generated on. I'm going to say this stuff. So that's a very common one. Typically not very useful, particularly in the age of Git, where what the source code is probably more usefully encoded as in the Git repository. I mean, it has history. To know when a binary was produced is of no real. Time zones and locales, so if you build a piece of software in one time zone and another time zone, the time timestamps can change, the calls can change, in that this not only means things get translated differently, but also collation order. So things often get sorted differently when you choose a different locale. Non-database file ordering, it's because of widespread use of EXT over the years, people have sort of thought that, or at least got the general impression, that iterating over the file system is deterministic, or at least if you redo a syscall once and then you do it again, you'll get the same results. This has never been guaranteed. It just so happens in EXT you tend to get that. And with all these newer file systems, we start to see different properties appearing. So anything that any compilation process that iterates over the file system, you know, to concatenate files into some sort of output file. If you have non-deterministic file ordering, then the output is going to differ. So therefore, your resultant binary is going to be non-deterministic and not reproducible. Because you have no guarantee that if you build it again, you're going to get the exact same cryptographic signature. Dictionary hash key ordering, very similar to the file ordering issue. Perl hashes, for example, if you iterate over the keys, they get returned in a non-deterministic order. Same with most Python dictionaries. That's changed in a very recent version of Python 3. But generally, hash and set iteration is non-deterministic. So any build artifacts that are based on that ordering or based on iterating over that ordering generally end up in the build being non-reproducible. Other things that leak into the environment are users groups, UMask environment variables, kernel version, all these sort of MISC things. So if a build process creates a file, it will obviously use the unit's UMask to create that file. And so if someone builds it with a different UMask, they will get a different result. Build paths is another common one. So a build process may accidentally include the build path as part of its sort of documentation in that sense. So I was built in home/lambda or whatever. But also this can be rather trickily encoded into assertions within the code. So within the binaries. So this is to help debug. To get tracebacks later, so say that this particular line of the assembly corresponds to main.c line 202, but it'll also include what path that this actually was built from, temp, whatever. This is very useful and all this non-reproducibility. So I've previously talked about the security advantages of having reproducible builds. There are actually a number of technical advantages. So even if you weren't a typical hacker, people have to get me, I don't run Bitcoin or whatever. Reproducible builds are still really useful for you. So one thing is that they detect accidentally corrupted build environments. So this is where you've installed some experimental version of you start building software and you're getting different results from other people. Ah, it's because you accidentally installed something to your main machine and things like that. Or you just generally broke on something horrible. It's much easier to test changes and revisions. So I use the property of my software being reproducible a lot, in that sometimes you make a change to a piece of software, and as in you might change the tests and things like that, and you actually expect nothing to change, although you've made changes to the source code. So what you can do is say, I replaced this or removed this piece of code, it shouldn't actually affect the binary. And when you have a reproducible build, you can say, the hash is the same before and after this change, therefore it can't have any result on the working of the binary because it's the same. It's the same thing. So, a reproducible build, by definition, has no unreliable, non-deterministic behavior. So it can't access the internet, it doesn't rely on timing and things like that in tests, which I'll show you some examples of later. There's all sorts of dodgy, random-based things like random scene-based generation. We just have a much build. I mean, if you have a reproducible build and your build is made out of a tree of dependencies, if you change something at the top, you might expect to have to rebuild everything below it. Fair enough. But if you change something at the bottom, you can rely on sort of essentially cache hits of previous things further up this chain. So this, you know, saves you time. You know, you're not having to rebuild things. You're also saving a lot of just, you know, CO2. I know that it saves Google a lot of money, but it's also the amount of computing being done sort of unnecessary because, oh, well, something changed in some parent build dependencies, we have to rebuild everything, and that's, you know, not good, basically. So I'm going to talk about reproducible builds within Debian now, specifically. What we do in Debian is we build every package twice in what we sort of affectionately call our sort of torture chest. We have on one side the A build and then the B build, and we try and vary as much as possible between them in order to flush out as many reproducible issues. So we're not expecting that every developer's machine varies in this way, but by adding all these variations, we can try and flush out as quickly as possible and identify all the issues in software. So let me just run through a few. We change the time and date. So, for example, the A build is done now, or whatever the current time is, but the B build is done sort of 19 months in the future, just because then that will immediately show differences in timestamps and things like that. It's done 19 months because doing 10 years breaks some software unnecessarily, causes, you know, various people's embedded SSL certificates to expire. More importantly, it changes over the year, so it's greater than 12 months, so anything that encodes the current year will change between these two binaries. The host name and domain name are different, the file system is deliberately different. We have a fuse-based file system called DisorderFS. Fuse is a way of writing file systems where in user space you can actually change their behavior quite easily. DisorderFS deliberately gives you the results in reverse sorted order. So on A, we give them in one order, and then on the B build, we give them in the reverse order, and that flush out any build algorithms, etc., that rely on, you know, concatenating files in the way I mentioned earlier. Time zone locale changed, UID good, all these kind of things, kernel, CPU type. This often changes compiler flags because it will say, oh, you're running some sort of AMD-ish machine, I'm going to add all these extra C flags and things like that. Those can result in a different build, so therefore, you vary. And we're always trying to add more crazy stuff to that. We also vary the build path. Very interesting. This is the current status. So green is the reproducible packages, and the orange is the unreproducible packages. And the ones that are just slightly above that are sort of broken. So we're making pretty good progress, and currently I think it's actually out of date, but currently we're at 93 or 94% reproducible, which isn't too bad. This is across like 23,000 source packages within Debian. The reason why the entire graph gets bigger is because all the time that we're doing this work, more packages are being added to Debian, so it's sort of rather, you know, pushing a block up the hill. But we're getting there. Beyond Debian, it's not definitely not a Debian specific project anymore. We've got people from all these other distributions, these embedded ones, BBSD, and even this is incomplete. And it's great to see this project that's got some real cross distro collaboration and buy-in. We had a summit in Berlin. And we had, I don't know, 20 different projects represented. It was really great, with different ideas and coming up with that. And it's a real it's using quote-unquote R testing framework, so the Debian testing framework, which is quite beefy, you know, something like 500 gigs of RAM total and things like that across, you know, 100 nodes and things like that. So all three different architectures, four different architectures. They're finding that very useful, and we're finding it very useful to find issues and things like that. Note that it's also F-droid, so it's sort of not only low-level things like OpenWRT or an EE2D firmware-based router software. It's also sort of more slightly higher-level software as well, like the Android stuff. As I mentioned, we have a really productive site. We're actually having another hackathon, a slightly smaller affair in Hamburg next week, which I'm really looking forward to. Again, completely cross-distribution, things like that. We have a bunch of tools that once were specifically Debian, and now they're completely abstract from that. Diffuscope, which I'll show you in a second. Disorder affairs, as I mentioned before. Strict non-determinism is a way of you pass it a file and you'll try and remove as much non-deterministic behavior as possible. Any artifacts, so if you give it a JSON file which contains which can contain a timestamp in the header, it'll strip that out for you. So if you can't modify a build process to not generate that in the first place, you can at least apply as a fallback, you can at least apply strict non-determinism to it and try and remove as much of these nasty timestamps as possible. Reprotest is a tool to perform a very similar operation to the torture test, vary the environment between two builds and then give you the results. Diffuscope. Diffuscope is a entirely generic tool for diff. I think we're a diff on steroids. So whilst your classic Unix diff will say, oh, you know, this file changes here in these particular bytes, what Diffuscope will do is try and provide a human-readable diff between two formats as much as possible. It'll also do recursive unpacking of files, so you can give it two ISO images, so you can give it a release candidate 1 or a release candidate 2 of some operating system. And it'll unpack the ISO, and within that, it'll unpack any tarballs, and within those, it will unpack any PDFs, and within those, it will unpack the pings and things like that, just to try and nail down what's actually changed. Because without that, if you just ran diff on these ISO, you would say, oh, all these random bytes have changed, and you're like, brilliant, I have no idea what the difference is actually. So at the top here, you can see SQL. So this is actually a dump and then a diff of a SQLite database. So this is just a .db file that was in some Mozilla extension, HTTPS anyway. So there's a SQLite database clearly in that, and instead of just showing the raw byte differences between the two, it'll actually show you it's actually inserting this different value. This is what it looks. And also reformat the XML, so that was presumably gzipped and often sort of rather ugly, and it's just sort of flattened out, so you can very quickly see, between 506 and 507, it's doing these slightly different things, which are extremely useful. There's a web-based version of this called try.diffuscope.org, and I encourage you all to go ahead and try that right now, if you have your laptops open. Upload two arbitrary files, and it'll run Diffuscope on them. So you don't need to install Diffuscope to your own machine, just to try it out. And that's very useful. And then you can share the results online, so sort of a sort of paste bin diff. As I say, it's steroids. I'd like to run through some rather interesting bugs that we found whilst finding reproducible builds, while working on reproducible builds. So this is sort of in the spirit of the Open Office can't print on Tuesdays bug, if anyone remembers that. Also, the case of the 500 mile email, that's a really interesting Usenet post worth reading. And cannot concatenate PDFs between April and December. This is a great one. You should look that one up and the reasons why. But perhaps ours aren't as celebrated as that, but they're equally like interesting. So as I mentioned, there were some really good advantages of reproducible builds that aren't to do with sort of tinfoil hat security, but at least just general useful security. So this was I don't think I'll name the package just in case. During the build, it would use a random number. I mean, it's not the best random number generator ever, but it would have encode a secret key into the configuration file, which would end up in you could share power, etc. And that's okay. That's random. It's quote unquote secure, absolutely fine. Except that one thing that you need to bear in mind is that as this is run on a build network, for example, Debian build network, once anyone who's running, who downloads this package, will get the same OpenID secret. So if I install it and you install it, we're going to get the same secret. And obviously, it's not very secret because we've got the same one, right? So, yeah, I mean, I'm no crypto expert, but I'm guessing that's not a good idea. Every installation, there you go. It's called GBrowse. It's now fixed, so that's fine. So, yeah, etc. Removing a lot of tests use wall clock time. So, is linear relative to row count? So, they basically times the input by 10, and they expect that the time that it's running doesn't exceed, this is assessing for, what do they call it, algorithmic complexity, big O notation. They're essentially ensuring it's in big O of N by just doing a timing on it. But this is unreliable behavior because what if you're doing stuff on the machine and doing other stuff on the machine and things like that. So removing this is a good idea. And so, yeah, so you can see that it fails if you put the machine under load. And then if you don't put it under load, it will start to pass again and things like that. So this is just not very good software engineering practice. So this is another bug, useful things that we flushed out. And this is extremely common. It's quite annoying. This is another package that fails to build 0.46% of the time. It's a tool to generate random data. And what it did was just basically generated random data and then just inserts, each time you run it, the set should include 8, you can see anything like that. But if it's random, you can get collisions. So if you keep running it, eventually you'll get the output of F will only include A and B. It won't include A, B, and C. And therefore, the build will fail, the assertion will fail, so the test fails. And you can do the combination in mathematics and work out that this is 0.46% of the time, which is very amusing to send upstream. Non-deterministic shebangs. This is so what was happening is that in our torture test, one build would have a shebang line, which is the line at the top of a script in Unix. One would say use a 3, or use a bin in Python 3, one would say use a bin in Python 3. No idea why. Just why would it do this? No idea. Eventually, I worked it out. So there's a Python help within Debian to rewrite shebangs. That's how you do this. But and it's to support multiple Python versions. If the build took less than 1 second, the distutils .py utilities thought that the file had not changed because it used a second-based resolution, and therefore the file that was rewritten was not installed to the target directory. And Python stuff builds pretty fast, and so a lot of the time it would build under 1 second, but then sometimes it wouldn't. So you hit up and enter, and sometimes it would be, and there's no random process here, so anyway, fix that. You also get some rather humorous upstreams adding their software based on the build time. So this is a particular game. If you download the source and you install it and build it from source within an hour of being released, you get a million bonus points in this particular game. But this might not. Random numpage. So this is Polygen. So Polygen is a humorous tool for generating random text. You give it a this looks like anyone familiar with programming languages design will recognize this and say, insert something like tool. So Polygon is a tool, and then he ran it again, saying Polygon is a system, etc. So every time, this is to generate a random humorous text for, like Markov chain things, etc. Polygen, of course, used Polygen for its own man page, because, hey, why not? Which meant that every time you built Polygen, you would get a different man page, which is good. And then they all were useful, and they all were descriptive of what Polygen did, but if you're trying to get a reproducible build, it's just not going to work, because every time you build, man page, therefore the cryptographic signature of the entire build process changes. So you just have to see it. So reproducible builds, future work. So, I mean, the source code is still vulnerable. So all the time through here, we've just basically assumed that the source code is free of all bugs, free of all malicious backdoors, accidental backdoors, and things like that. So we're kind of sticking ahead in the sand about the source code, but reproducible builds is only really interested on the compilation side. So your source code still needs eyeballs to be looked at and things like that. In other words, it doesn't save you from everything. The other issue is how to make the results meaningful for end users. So for example, if a piece of software is reproducible or not reproducible, how is that displayed to an end user? Apt get install Nginx, it says, okay, I see what you're trying to do, but I don't think Nginx is reproducible, so I'm not sure you can trust the binary that I'm about to install. Do you want to continue, yes or no? Is that what we want to expose to users? It's a little bit weird. I mean, do they care? And what does non-reproducible mean in that context? If you saw remember the example earlier with Alice, Bob and Carol, that was only three actors there. It should clearly include a lot more, but I mean, how many people have to agree before something is reproducible from the user's point of view? What does it really mean for an end user? Things like that. So, hopefully that's piqued your interest in reproducible builds. If you'd like to get involved, we have a website, reproducablebuilds.org, an IRC channel. Do check your own software. Just build it once, build it twice, just see whether the SHA-1 sign is the same. And then try and remove it as much as possible. It probably means you're using dates, and if so, you can use our environment variable called source date epoch, which you can just use your favorite search engine to find more about that. I'd like to thank the Linux Foundation and the Core Infrastructure Initiative for funding work and hardware, etc. in this area. So if there's any questions, please let me know. Please wait for the microphone, I believe. Thank you very much.
Do you plan to have a requirement in the future for Debian packages to always be reproducible? Because now you showed like the ratio between the number of reproducible packages, and there was still some part that weren't.
So that's right, yes. So currently, there's due to be a new release of Debian fairly soon, ish soon, how Debian works, right? At least how Debian releases work. After that, we do plan to have to propose at least that. That at least to begin with, that Debian packages should be reproducible, and then perhaps throughout the release cycle, try and enforce that. Whether that means that they have to be, otherwise they don't hit the next release, what internally in Debian we call an RC bug, a release critical bug, whether it becomes a requirement, a hard requirement, is up to debate at this point. Because it's currently fairly non-trivial to test on a local developer's machine. So in other words, if overnight we said, yeah, all packages must be reproducible, it's like, well, my package isn't, and I don't know why, and I can't actually hack on that. That seems a little bit unfair as a developer person. In an ideal world, yes. And certainly there will be some, definitely a big push for the next release of Debian.
most of your packages were reproducible to show in the graph. Is it the same with Ubuntu and those building on you, or are they lowering the results again? You say modify a number of files.
I think they will certainly be lower. That's probably mostly because they may not have incorporated various toolchain fixes that we have. So a lot of the time you can fix each package individually. You know, if they have specific things like the gene routes, the OpenID, things like that. But a lot of packages are non-reproducible because something that generates them, like some sort of help program or that's inserting timestamps. You know, documentation generator is adding them. So if you add a patch for that, you immediately fix 500 packages. And so if Ubuntu hasn't synced it or don't want to carry that patch or they just haven't seen it yet, whatever, then that would just necessarily apply to their lower and things like that. You had a second part to your question. Okay, brilliant, sorry. Okay.
So, have you considered doing any work on a binary format or container that users can verify after installing that they still have the same now reproducibly produced binary on their system?
No. We basically are focused just on in the same way that we're sort of ignoring the issues of rootkits in the original source. We're also ignoring any issues of, your machine was subsequently compromised, things like that. There are tools on many operating systems distributions that can examine and see whether files have been corrupted and things like that. But that's not something that we're concentrating on, just looking at the build process.
Okay, so that might be included in future work then.
I think so, yeah. Clearly important avenue.
So I think we have one more on the other side.
So at the beginning you said everybody has to fully trust all Debian packages essentially, because if you don't, if any of them could be compromised either by force or because somebody hacked any of those systems. How many Debian developers are there in total?
Approximately 1,000.
Alright, so if any of these 1,000 systems is compromised in any way, you can't trust all of Debian because they all have full access, correct?
Correct.
You would say this is an issue you would have solved a little sooner.
That's it.
Now how do other distributions deal with that?
So this is slightly orthogonal issue to reproducible build, in a sense. I mean, it's more a question of who has what upload rights and things like that. So whilst I definitely share your concern, there are steps to move towards, there are steps to move away from that kind of thing, to the Debian like not having, not uploading binaries, but uploading source only. What we call source-only uploads and things like that, that's in the process of being adopted. In terms of other distributions, I can't really speak for how they are addressing this particular issue. I mean, if you have upload rights for, I make it up, Fedora, you presumably just upload any other crap, right, in the same way. So, does that speak to your question?
It just surprised me a little bit. I mean, my company has like two-factor authentication over every single piece of infrastructure, and even on GitHub, where you can track any change that is made anywhere and always undo it, and always it's all very transparent. Even there, our developers all have to have two-factor authentication, because even though it could be seen, it could be checked, and everybody's keeping an eye on it, it's still possible somebody might put something in, and then this sounds like a 1,000 gaping holes thing.
Yes, but that's not necessarily specific to reproducible builds. It means that's when you basically have a huge source tree. Anyone can make these changes. Yes, you should add two-factor authentication, strong keys, and lockdown.
You know, do you guys train the developers in that? Is there any emphasis on this?
Yes, during the Debian new maintainer process, it is underlined that your PGP key, it's pretty obvious that your GPG key is something that you should take a lot of care of. We throw away insecure ones, like we got rid of all the 1024-bit RSA keys very quickly, and things like that. And we prune our key ring fairly often. But yes, this is just, I would say it's not a unique problem to us in that sense. So I feel, whilst I might sound a bit defensive on that, it's going to, this problem affects any large organization that doesn't want to, can't or doesn't really want to have, very fine-grained ACL access control. That's, only you can upload the Apache package, only I can upload the Nginx package. For example.
At least what you said earlier, like only, uploading source, at least, then if
yes.
The builds are done on a number of systems that you guys own and control, that's a huge step forward.
Absolutely, yes. And that is one thing we are moving towards.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thanks for the answer.
More hands before I sneak in my question.
Regarding the security of the open source code, I was wondering if there were any incidents that open source developer who decided to introduce a malicious code in the source way in the code. And for example, if you figure out that there is another function in another file which has a little bug, for example, Stack Overflow, and he uses another function in another file which might call that function and take advantage, and he writes an open source code for that, and the reviewers get it unnoticed. Have there been any kind of incident like that before or not?
I'm not aware of any. Is anyone here aware of any? But we just don't know. It's just kind of a bit scary, but yeah.
Yeah, but that risk exists.
Yes, absolutely, yeah. And reproducible builds would help you in that sense, because everyone rebuilding would have that same compromised source code. So, alas.
So you mentioned a number of projects being a part of reproducible builds. Is Yocto or the BitBake people to open a part of it? But the list ended with .. So I guess
yes.
It's longer.
There is a full list on the reproducible build website. I believe certainly there are a few more embedded folks that I really should add to that slide. I can't speak directly for those, but they certainly sound awfully familiar. In terms of reproducible context, things like that.
Because there you have the same problem that I guess OpenWRT had, that you want the entire firmware image to
yes.
be a bit identical.
That's right, yeah. But you also have things further up the abstraction there as well. The next release of the Tails Amnesiac operating system, and it's a live CD for that anonymizes you and things like that, runs everything over Tor. The next release of that will be entirely reproducible. So yeah, there's lots of other options.
Any more
so you said in order to verify if everything checks out well, you build it twice with different host name, all those things in the list, but. You mentioned that maybe other parties or persons should build it. Do you apply that as well?
Currently, no.
Mm-hmm.
Apart from, silly tests on my own machine. There is a